There is only one way, and if you have not put your trust in Jesus Christ, you will die and go to hell. It is that simple. It is that plain. I kind of thought about what John said about foolishness of preaching. You don't have to be a fool up here, but it seems foolish that a few words, it says even nigh unto thy lips, where it's like you could express a few words and it would change eternity. That all you have to do is believe Christ and what he has done, and that changes your life forever. But it seems foolish because we want to work our way there.
No, the thunder it did roll, and the wind it did blow, as they walked down the streets single file. And the blood began to flow from the crown of thorns he wore, as he walked that impossible mile. Yes, he walked.
Good morning, everyone. It is some sort of nerve-wracking coming up here to stand before the people and to bring a message. But I am thankful we have a God who provides us the way, gives us the words to say, and he gives us the power to do it. So what Abe preached or prayed there a little bit made me think a bit about the resurrection and hope. So in Proverbs 16:25, it says, "There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death." I remember when I was a Christian a couple of years, and my wife wasn't saved yet. And I was really getting into Christian music, Christian movies, and all this sort of stuff. And I remember pulling her aside one day, and I told her, I was like, "Hon, the way I'm living," I was like, "the way the Christian church is today," I was like, it seems right. Everyone is doing it. We have these good movies, these books, these theologians, all these things, and Christianity is getting popular. I just told her, it seems like things, it seems right. It seemed right unto me. But then when I read this passage there, I pulled her aside and I was like, but it says here in Proverbs, "But the end thereof are the ways of death." So there is a way that can seem right unto us where we think we're going to go to heaven, but the end thereof is the way of death. And that's something I would like to talk about today, a false hope. Before I was born again, I had a false hope. I was a Mennonite, and I had a hope that one day maybe I will get to heaven. So if you will turn with me to 2 Timothy 3:1, it says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good," that is today, "despisers of those that are good, traitors, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God." So this Christian life that I was living, it felt good to me. When I read, I listened, it seemed spiritual. The way they talked about God and love and all this, it seemed right unto me that I was doing the right thing. It says, "Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God." But to me, that is something that I think we need to be warned about, is all these feelings-based salvation. If our salvation isn't in the Word of God, right, we have no salvation. 3:5, "Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away." That's something that I've been thinking about a long time, especially when I looked at the churches, where I grew up, where they would preach the Word of God, yet they would deny the power thereof because they don't think that what God has done is able to keep us, that His Word is able to save us, that His blood atones for our sin. And it says, in their form of godliness, they have denied Christ. So even the Jews, when you look at the Jews, they had a form of godliness. And then someone who was actually God came and preached unto them, and yet they hated him. Why did they hate him? Because godliness that came from within. Theirs was outwardly, they had a show of godliness, but Christ was within that came out. If you look at, I kind of looked up Catholics, so they also, they would seem godly. When you look at their life, they are very, I don't know if you want to say pious, they fast, they seem holy, yet their end is still death and hell because they have not put their trust in Christ alone. They have idols, they worship instead of God alone. And even the Mormons, right, they have a works-based salvation. They also have a false hope. I look at Mennonites, I look at almost all religions have a false hope. They have a way of salvation that they think is going to get them to heaven, but the scriptures are clear that there is only one man to whom we get through God, and that is the man Christ Jesus and through his blood. So one thing that they deny, to me, would be they deny the power of God. And it is the power of God that saves us, right? So if his blood paid for our sins, we're trusting in what the Bible says, is that through that power, that's how we become a child of God. 2 Timothy 4:3 says, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." People don't like to hear the truth. People don't like when you convict them of their sin. So many of us, and I think there are in most churches, I would say that not everyone there is born again. And if my brother was kind of saying, a pastor had said this, where if you're not born again, you would think after a year, a couple of months, you would leave the church. If they're preaching the truth, how could you stand in fellowship with men who are standing for truth? Because light exposes darkness, right? So if you're standing for the truth, and if you're living a godly life, they would get convicted. Either they would love their sin more and they would leave the church, or to me it would be kind of like Pharaoh with their heart in their heart and think they're righteous and pious, and yet they'd still be damned and go to hell. So a false hope. 2 Timothy 3:6. "For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captivity, captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth." So still having a form of godliness, doing Bible studies, all these things are great. But if you don't love the Lord, if you don't love truth, there is still no hope in that. Colossians 2:18 says, "Let no man beguile you with your reward in a voluntary humility of worshiping of angels, introducing into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up, and by his fleshy mind, and not holding the head from which all the body of joints, bands having nourishment, ministered, and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are ye subject to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which all are to perish with the using, after the commandments and doctrines of men, which indeed have a shew of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh." So again, it shows wisdom in will worship, where you're denying the flesh. It seems holy to pray every morning for an hour. It seems holy to study the Bible and go out and witness to people. All of it seems holy, yet still it doesn't bring salvation. It is still a false hope to do all these things. There is only one way. Again, our true hope is in Christ. And these of neglecting of the body is only to satisfy the flesh. So all the things about the Christian music, Christian movies. I'm not trying to bash any of that. But what I'm saying is some of it, it shows godliness. It has a show a way of portraying what we should be or how we should act. Yet I think still some of it is will worship and is not in the truth. 2 Timothy 3:8, now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth, men of corrupt minds, and reprobate concerning the faith. So these were the magicians in Pharaoh's day when Moses came and preached unto them. These were the men that were, they withstood Moses, because whenever Moses did a sign, these men would do a sign also. In Exodus 8:19 it says, then the magicians said unto Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. And Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he hearkened not unto them, as the Lord had said. So previously, they were able to do all the miracles that Moses was able to. But then in 18 there, he created lice. And they said, this is the finger of God. They could not do that. Yet, it hardened Pharaoh's heart. Even though they saw the truth, it hardened their heart. Exodus 9:11 again, and the magicians could not stand before Moses because of the boils. For the boils was upon the magicians and upon all the Egyptians. So these had seemed to have the power of God upon them because they could do the same thing that Moses did in front of the people, yet their end was still destruction. It says in 3:9, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men as theirs was. So their folly was shown in the end that what they had was a false hope. They worshipped false gods and they were not serving the true God. So even the magicians recognized the power of God, yet they did not turn to him. Even Pharaoh hardened his heart. So Matthew 7:21 says, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many shall say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. So in the end times, and when the church is raptured out, the tribulation is over, when we all see Christ, there will be those who think they're going to heaven because they worked the works of God. They cast out devils, they prayed, they prophesied, they did all these things, and none of it was truly of their heart. All of it was outwardly. It was the outwardly righteousness. They deceived themselves. They deceived others. He says, and then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. They thought they were doing God's will, but they were only serving their own flesh and their own desires. They wanted to be puffed up. People love to be seen of men in what they do. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith, prove your own selves, know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? So it says, you will know yourselves if you are in the faith. All of us actually know if we are born again or not. Like John said, if you don't know where you're going, you're dying and going to hell. The scripture is so clear, if you don't know, there is only one way, and if you have not put your trust in Jesus Christ, that you will die and go to hell. It is that simple. It is that plain. I kind of thought about what John said about foolishness of preaching. You don't have to be a fool up here, but it seems foolish that a few words, it says even nigh unto thy lips, where it's like you could express a few words and it would change eternity. That all you have to do is believe Christ and what he has done, and that changes your life forever. But it seems foolish because we want to work our way there. Most of us are Mennonites here. We are born and raised that we have to work our way to heaven. And what Abe Gunther said there, we would of men all be hopeless if it wasn't for the resurrection, right? Jesus Christ rose again, that we who believe on him have a hope. This hope is eternal, and that's what gives us the strength and power to go out and preach the gospel and not focus on worldly things here. 1 Peter 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. That is a lively hope. To an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. That's a real hope. The real hope is that Christ died on the cross, that he shed his blood for our sins, and that he rose again, and that we are now seated in heavenly places with him, the Bible says. That is a sure hope. Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now, for a season, if need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations. I don't know about you guys, but this world does tempt us. It has so many things it offers us. All of it is only temporal joy, temporal peace. All of it is going to be destroyed when God throws it in hell or the lake of fire. He says death and hell will be thrown into the lake of fire. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. So now that we have a real hope, people will hate us. If you share the gospel with people, they will hate you because they love their sin, the Bible says. And righteousness convicts them. If we're not out there teaching, and again, this is not that we should be persecuted here, or we're not Christians because we're not persecuted. We do live in a free land where it has been accepted. You know, Christians have been noble people. But I think the hypocrites, all those who aren't born again, who live in sin, they are actually going to, in a way, I think, make it harder for real Christians. Because the world is going to look at them and say, that's a real Christian. You're living in adultery, and that's a real Christian. They're going to hate you, especially if you speak the truth. 1:8, whom having not seen ye love. Did I miss 7? Nope. 1:8, whom having not seen ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. That's just like in Hebrews, right? We have Hebrews chapter 11 of faith. And yet Abraham, by faith, the Jews, by faith. So where's the one where... So Abraham, by faith, believed God. When he said there was going to be a new city, which builders and foundations are made of God, he believed God and followed him. So that is just like us now. You know, we had when Christ died, rose again, Thomas, doubting Thomas, he saw Christ, he felt his imprints, what Christ had done for us, and he said, blessed are you, for you see, but blessed are those that see not and yet believe. So all of us have a hope, and a sure hope, and if we trust the word of God, it is sure. Receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls, 1:9, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what manner of time the Spirit of Christ shall come unto them, did signify, when it testified beforehand the suffering of Christ and the glory that should be. Now think about that. Our salvation was prophesied. The prophets wrote it. It was prophesied, yet they searched the Scriptures, it says, searching what or what manner of time. So that's God ordained. If I write something, I just heard this yesterday, if I write something, I know what I wrote. But these prophets were moved of God, and as they wrote the Scriptures, they searched the Scriptures because they didn't write it, right? God is the one who wrote the Scriptures. And that's why the book is above us. God wrote the book. And that's why we trust the book. Unto whom it was revealed, not unto themselves, so right, they didn't reveal it unto themselves, but unto us they did minister. So they didn't even know. This wasn't even written for them, it says. Unto whom it was revealed, right, is written, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. So even the angels in heaven didn't understand what was prophesied here. And I think in Paul there was, it was revealed too as well. He said he revealed mysteries, right? That the Gentiles should be saved as well. And that the scriptures is for all nations now, everyone, not the Jews only. So that again, that is a sure hope. God prophesied in the beginning that the Gentiles would be saved. Anyone who would believe on Jesus Christ would be saved. That was not known as it is today. 1:12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. It is not our power that saves us. It is by the power of God that saves us unto Jesus Christ. Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation, to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. 1 Corinthians 1:18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. So the world looks at us as fools. We are trusting, we think we're, you know, it's like some people think people who are down and out or do drugs and stuff like that, maybe they need a cane, but any regular person doesn't need someone to stand upon. But to us, it is the power of God. It is not foolishness. To anyone who doesn't believe the cross, to them I think they are fools. They have trusted in themselves, they have trusted in someone else or in another religion instead of trusting the Word of God and God Almighty who created heaven and earth. 1 Corinthians 1:24. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. 2:5. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. This one is a big one for me. This is probably my second time only really being up here ever preaching. And we just left Hawaii, and I told my wife, you know what? I said, I hope our van breaks down and somebody else can go and preach. She's like, I don't think I can go up there and preach the word of God. We weren't more than 5 minutes out of town. Our transmission, I got lights coming up. I had to pull over. I was like, this is good. This is good. But I wouldn't want to make John or John come up here not knowing. I feel so incapable. So incapable. But it is not me that comes up here and preaches the word of God, right? It is God's word that has the power. I am merely a mouthpiece. If we don't trust the word of God or the words that are being spoken here, then we do not love God. What makes a believer is the love of the truth, the love of the brethren. The love of God. That's what's going to separate us in the end. It's going to be the love. Do we love God? Do we love the brethren? The world has a false love. They love their own, Bible says, they love their own. What profit is it to us if we love our own? The world does that, right? What sets a Christian apart? It's the love of God. That's what sets us apart from this world. For though he was crucified, 2 Corinthians 13:4, for though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. That is, to me, a pretty powerful statement. You think about God Almighty himself was crucified on the cross for our sins. Now, he is the one who created heaven and earth, and yet mere man put him on the cross for our sins. The day is coming, and Paul said it 2,000 years ago, and is it almost already there? We are almost there. I think we're at the doorstep. The day is coming where people will recognize who God is, what Christ has done, and they will lament. Think about it. That's what I think about. Think about my family who aren't born again. I should do a better job of ministering to them. I heard one guy say, I was listening to a preacher, and he said, he was working, so he got born again, and everybody knew it, because he wouldn't stop preaching to the people at work. And he said, there was this big guy, God had said, hey, I want you to speak to that man. I'll say his name, same as John. And he's like, that big man? He's like, yeah, I want you to speak to that man. So he went to him, and he said, hey, do you know that Christ died for you? He's like, I don't want you to talk to me. He's like, oh, Lord, like, why do you want me to talk to him? The next day again, Lord's like, I want you to talk to that man. The next day he goes back, and he says, hey, I want you to know Christ died for you. He's like, I don't want your religion. I don't want you. I want you to talk to me. The next day, he did it for a week or two. And then he went to the boss and complained. He said, this man won't leave me alone. So the boss moved him to the other side of the factory. And then that man who was preaching, who was witnessing to him, one day he had to do a new job. He said, hey, I want you to go to that side of the building, this factory. There's going to be a machine there, and someone's going to come and teach you how to run that machine there. So he went there. He waited like 15 minutes. He's like, okay, somebody's coming. Somebody's going to teach me. And that man, John, came. And he's like, what? Won't you leave me alone? Why are you here? And he said, look, I want to tell you something. Will you listen to me for a little bit? He said, I want to tell you something. When that day comes, that you know I'm a Christian, and you know you're going to hell. When that day comes, say if there was a line here, there's just, you know, a line there, and I'm going to be there, and you're going to be there, you're going to die and go to hell, I'm going to go to heaven, and you're going to look over at me. Like, what are you going to think? Aren't you going to think, why didn't you tell me? Why didn't you tell me that that road there leads to hell and that one goes to heaven, where God said he's making mansions for us? And here you just watch me, you're working, right? We work with people that don't know they're dying, going to hell. And he said, look, why didn't you tell me? He's like, I want to tell you something. This is what I'm trying to tell you. He's like, okay, that makes sense. He's like, okay, I'll let you speak to me. And he witnessed to him. See, people think they trust their works, they trust all these things, but they don't know they have been deceived, and God has made it that way. Those who don't want God and his righteousness, God has made it in such a way that the world deceives us and pulls us away from him, because God only wants them that love him. And that's a real hope. 2 Timothy 1:8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. Right, we are not to be ashamed of what God has done for us and through us. We are supposed to stand boldly on the grace of God, on the word of God, and teach people. Final one, 1:5, 1 Peter 1:5. I know, John, you want to preach on 1 Peter, but I'll use some of it. We who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last day. There's going to be a time, it's going to be revealed who we love. Right? If we're in here and we don't actually love God, love the brethren, it's going to be known. We can throw up a front right now, but it will be revealed in the last time. When judgment comes, right, either you're going to be going to hell or you're going to go to heaven. Right? It says, choose ye this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And let us, as men, I think, should stand on the truth, especially in where we work. I am preaching to myself here, that I can stand for God's word. Why don't we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for, again, such a beautiful day where we can gather together here as believers. Lord, I do pray for wisdom for all the men and those who are born again, child of God, washed in the blood, that we can be strong in faith. Lord, we have a real hope. We have a way of salvation that the scripture says that there's a day coming, Lord, we cannot even fathom the things you have prepared for us. To think that such a short time here that we'd spend idolizing and working on ourselves instead of going out there and witnessing and winning souls for you, Lord. People who are dying, going to hell, need the gospel, and they need us to share that real hope with them. As Jesus said, when he looked up, lo, the field is white and ready, Lord. There are people out there yearning to know the truth, and help us to be the mouthpiece there, that we can witness and share God's word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.